चैप्टर वी आर गोइंग टू डू इज़ द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट चैप्टर शॉक एंड ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूजन. गाइज वी आर ट्राइंग टू कम्प्लीट द लव एंड बेली विच इज़ एडिशन 27 अकॉर्डिंग टू द सिंगल लाइनर और नीट पैटर्न इन नीट सुपर स्पेशलिटी एंड नीट पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन एंट्रेंस टेस्ट. दिस इज़ द सेकेंड चैप्टर. इट इज़ अ होल सीरीज. वी विल कम्प्लीट ऑल द चैप्टर्स ऑफ बेली. सो दिस इज चैप्टर 2, Shock and blood transfusion. Introduction. Shock is the most common and therefore the most important cause of death in surgical patients. Very important. It is the most common and also the most important cause of the death in surgical patients. And death may occur rapidly due to the profound state of shock or be delayed due to the consequences of organ ischemia or reperfusion injury. It is important therefore that every surgeon understands the pathophysiology, diagnosis and priorities in management of shock and hemorrhage. What is shock? Shock is a systemic state of low tissue perfusion that is inadequate for normal cellular respiration. With insufficient delivery of oxygen and glucose, cells switch from aerobic to anaerobic metabolism. If perfusion is not restored in a timely fashion, cell death ensues. Pathophysiology, cellular pathophysiology. As perfusion to the tissue is reduced, cells are deprived of oxygen and must switch from aerobic to anaerobic metabolism. The product of anaerobic respiration is not carbon dioxide but lactic acid. The product of anaerobic respiration is lactic acid. When enough tissue is underperfused, the accumulation of lactic acid in the blood produces a systemic. So first it is systemic metabolic acidosis. So as glucose within cells is exhausted, the aerobic respiration ceases and there is failure of sodium-potassium pump. There is failure in the later ends, in the cell membrane and intracellular organelles. So intracellular lysosome release the autodigestive enzymes and cell lysis ensues. Intracellular contents including potassium are released into the bloodstream. So what will release into the bloodstream? It is potassium. Microvascular pathophysiology. As tissue ischemia progresses, changes in the local milieu results in activation of the immune and coagulation system. Hypoxia and acidosis activate the complement and prime neutrophils, resulting in the generation of oxygen-free radicals and cytokine release. These mechanisms led to the injury of the capillary endothelial cells. There will be injury to the capillary endothelial cells, and this in turn further activate the immune and coagulation system. Damaged endothelium loses its integrity and becomes leaky endothelium. Spaces between the endothelial cells allow fluid to leak out and tissue edema ensues, exacerbating the cellular hypoxia. Systemic pathophysiology. The cardiovascular system, as preload and afterload are decreasing, there is compensatory baroreceptor response, resulting in increased sympathetic activity and release of catecholamines in the circulation. And this is not happening in sepsis. This is not happening in sepsis, and this is an MCQ. Respiratory pathophysiology. Respiratory, the metabolic acidosis and increased sympathetic response result in increased respiratory rate and minute ventilation. Your sympathetic response is increased. The metabolic acidosis is there and it will cause increased respiratory rate and minute ventilation. To increase the excretion of carbon dioxide, you have to excrete the carbon dioxide. So you have to increase the minute ventilation and increase the respiratory rate, and it will produce compensatory respiratory alkalosis. So initially there is metabolic acidosis which eventually turn up into respiratory alkalosis. Renal pathophysiology. The decreased perfusion pressure in the kidney leads to reduced filtration of the glomerulus and decreased urine output. The renin-angiotensin aldosterone axis is stimulated. The RAS system is activated, resulting in further vasoconstriction and increased sodium and water resorption by the kidney. If you look at the endocrine system, as well as the activation of the adrenal and renin-angiotensin systems, the vasopressin, which is the antidiuretic hormone, is also released from the hypothalamus because you have to conserve the water loss in response to decreased preload. It is actually in response to decreased preload, and it results in vasoconstriction and resorption of water in the renal collecting system. The antidiuretic hormone, vasopressin, it causes vasoconstriction as well as resorption of water in the renal collecting system. Cortisol is also released from the adrenal cortex. Cortisol is also released from the adrenal cortex, contributing to the sodium and water resorption and sensitize the cell to the catecholamines. Both are this function, the sodium and water resorption and sensitizing the cells to catecholamines. Ischemia reperfusion syndrome. This is very important. So during the period of systemic hyperperfusion, cellular and organ damage progresses due to the direct effects of tissue hypoxia and local activation of inflammation. Now, further injury occurs once the normal circulation is restored. When the normal circulation is restored, there will occur further injury. Now, the acid and potassium load that has built up can lead to direct myocardial depression. Now, metabolic acidosis and potassium leak was there. We have read previously. So, this acid and potassium load is causing myocardial depression, vascular dilatation, and further hypotension. So, the cellular and humoral elements, they activated the hypoxia. Hypoxia is activating the complement, neutrophils, microvascular thrombi, and they are flushed back into the circulation. Flushed back into the circulation, and where they cause the further endothelial injury to organs such as the lungs and kidneys. So, lungs and kidneys are most commonly involved, and also the myocardium. These three organs are involved in ischemia reperfusion syndrome. So, this leads to acute lung injury, acute renal injury, multiple organ failure and death. Reperfusion injury can currently only be attenuated by reducing the extent and duration of tissue hypoperfusion. So you have to control the extent of reperfusion by controlling your extent and duration of tissue hypoperfusion. It can only be attenuated by reducing the extent and duration of tissue hyperperfusion. Classification of shock. There are numerous ways to classify shock, but the most common, most important, applicable one based on the initiating mechanism. All states are characterized by systemic tissue hyperperfusion, and different states may coexist with the same patient. These are the classifications of shock: hypovolemic shock, cardiogenic shock, obstructive shock, and distributive and endocrine shock. Hypovolemic shock is the most common type of shock. Hypovolemic shock is due to reduced circulating volume. Hypovolemia may be due to the hemorrhagic or non-hemorrhagic causes. Non-hemorrhagic causes include poor fluid intake, that is dehydration, excessive fluid loss due to vomiting, diarrhea, urinary loss in diabetes insipidus, evaporation, or third spacing, where fluid is lost into the GI tract and interstitial spaces. For example, in bowel obstruction or pancreatitis. So, hypovolemia is probably the most common form of shock. Hypovolemia is the most common cause of, most common form of shock. So, absolute or relative hypovolemia must be excluded or treated in the management of shock state regardless of the cause. Cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock is due to the primary failure of the heart to pump blood to the tissues. Causes of cardiogenic shock include myocardial infarction, cardiac dysrhythmias, valvular heart diseases, blunt myocardial injury, and cardiomyopathy. Cardiac insufficiency may also be due to myocardial depression caused by endogenous factors, bacterial and humoral agents related to sepsis, or exogenous factors. What are the endogenous factors? These are the bacterial or humoral agents related in released in sepsis, or the exogenous factors such as pharmaceutical agents or drug abuse. And evidence of venous hypertension with pulmonary or systemic edema may coexist with the classical signs of shock. Evidence of venous hypertension with pulmonary or systemic edema may coexist with the classical signs of shock. So you have to check for the venous hypertension also, along with the pulmonary and systemic edema. Obstructive shock. In obstructive shock, there is reduction in preload due to mechanical obstruction of cardiac filling. There is reduction in the preload due to mechanical obstruction of cardiac filling. Common causes of obstructive shock include cardiac tamponade, tension pneumothorax, massive pulmonary embolism, or air embolism. Very important, the causes of obstructive shock. They are obstructing the cardiac filling. That is cardiac tamponade, tension pneumothorax, massive pulmonary embolism, or air embolism. In each case, there is reduced filling of the left and right side of the heart, leading to reduced preload and a foreign cardiac output. Distributive shock. Distributive shock describes the pattern of cardiovascular response characterizing a variety of conditions, including septic shock. This includes septic shock, anaphylactic shock, and spinal cord injury. inadequate organ perfusion is accompanied by vascular dilatation with hypotension. There is inadequate organ perfusion because of vascular dilatation with hypotension, low systemic vascular resistance, inadequate afterload, and resulting abnormally high cardiac output. Very, very important. All these features are very important. Direct line MCQs they are, because there is vascular resistance is reduced. Also, the cardiac output is actually high. There is, though there is hypotension, there is low systemic vascular resistance. In anaphylaxis, what happens in anaphylaxis? In anaphylaxis, the vasodilation is due to the histamine release, which is, while in high spinal cord injury, there is failure of sympathetic flow and adequate vascular tone. So actually it is neurogenic shock. So high spinal cord injury is causing the sympathetic flow obstruction, the failure of sympathetic flow, and there is no adequate vascular tone, leading to neurogenic shock. The cause in sepsis is less clear, but is related to the release of bacterial products. These are endotoxins. So endotoxins are actually responsible for the septic shock. So there are three types of distributing shock we just now recollected. First is anaphylactic shock, in which there is massive histamine release. While in high spinal cord injury, there is failure of sympathetic outflow and adequate vascular tone, which is a neurogenic shock. Then there is septic shock. Septic shock is because of endotoxins and the activation of cellular and humoral components of the immune system. There is maldistribution of blood flow at a microvascular level with arteriovenous shunting and dysfunction in the cellular utilization of tissues. There is maldistribution of blood flow at a microvascular level with arteriovenous shunting and dysfunction of cellular utilization. Cells, the tissues are not able to utilize the oxygen properly. In the later phases of septic shock, there is hypovolemia from the fluid loss into the interstitial spaces, and that is happening in the later stages of the shock, later stages of septic shock. There may be concomitant myocardial depression complicating the clinical picture. There comes the endocrine shock. Endocrine shock may present as a combination of hypovolemic, cardiogenic, or distributing shock. It may present as a combination of hypovolemic, cardiogenic, or distributing shock. Causes of endocrine shock including the hypo and hyper, both hyper and hypo and hyperthyroidism, hypo and hyperthyroidism, adrenal insufficiency, hypoadrenalism. Hypothyroidism is causing a shock state similar to that of neurogenic shock due to the disorder vascular and cardiac responsiveness to circulating catecholamines. Cardiac output falls due to the low inotropy and bradycardia. There may also be an associated cardiomyopathy. Thyrotoxicosis may cause a high cardiac output failure. Thyrotoxicosis is causing high cardiac output failure, while the hypothyroidism is actually causing bradycardia, low inotropy, and cardiomyopathy. Adrenal insufficiency leads to shock due to hypovolemia. So adrenal insufficiency is due to hypovolemia and a poor response to circulating and exogenous catecholamines. Adrenal insufficiency may be due to pre-existing Addison's disease. Adrenal insufficiency may be due to pre-existing Addison's disease or be a relative insufficiency due to pathological disease state such as sepsis. So sepsis may also cause your adrenal insufficiency, or Addison's disease may also cause adrenal insufficiency. So there are two causes of adrenal insufficiencies. Then cardiovascular and metabolic characteristic of shock in different types of shock. In hypovolemia, the cardiac output is low. Obviously, there is low preload, so there is cardiac output, reduced cardiac output. A resistance will be high because of vasoconstriction. The venous pressure will be low because of decreased afterload also, decreased preload, and mixed venous oxygen saturation is low. Only mixed venous saturation is high in distributive shock. Very important that distributive shock like the sepsis, the neurogenic shock and anaphylaxis, these three may cause increased mixed venous saturation, because tissues are not able to utilize the oxygen. So mixed venous oxygen saturation is actually high. Base deficit is high in every type of shock. It is high in every type of shock. Base deficit will be high in every type of shock. Vascular resistance will be low in only distributive shock. These points are important, and cardiac output will be high in distributive shock. So distributive shock is actually an interesting thing. It is having high cardiac output, low vascular resistance, and high mixed venous oxygen saturation, though the venous pressure will be reduced because of low sympathetic tone. Tests are having more or less the equal features or similar features. The cardiogenic shock is having low cardiac output, it is having high venous vascular resistance, and venous pressure is actually high. So to differentiate between a cardiogenic shock and hypovolemic shock, you should look for the venous pressure. For example, the central venous pressure. If your central venous pressure is high, it is cardiogenic shock. If central venous pressure is low, it is hypovolemic shock. Severity of shock. Compensatory tone. As shock progresses, the body's cardiovascular and endocrine compensatory response reduces the flow to non-essential organs. The body's cardiovascular and endocrine compensatory responses reduces the flow to the non-essential organs to preserve the preload and flow to the lungs and brain. So the preload and flow to the lungs and brain is almost kept normal till the last. So in compensated shock, there is adequate compensation to maintain the cerebral central blood volume. There is adequate compensation to maintain the central blood volume and preserve the flow to the kidneys, lungs, and brain. Apart from the tachycardia and cool peripheries in due to vasoconstriction and circulating catecholamines, there may be no other clinical signs of hypovolemia. In compensated shock, there will be no other clinical signs of hypovolemia if it is compensated, other than the vasoconstriction and circulating catecholamines causing the cool peripheries. Tachycardia and cool peripheries will be seen in compensated shock. However, this cardiovascular state is only maintained by reducing the perfusion to the skin. They have reduced the perfusion to the skin, muscle, and gastrointestinal tract, and there is systemic metabolic acidosis and activation of humoral and cellular elements within the underperfused organs. Although the clinically occult, this state will lead to multiple organ failure and death if prolonged due to ischemia reperfusion. We saw that when there is ischemia, it is causing increased lactate in the tissues and also increased potassium leak from the damaged endothelial layer of damaged vascular endothelium. So when there is potassium leaked out and also the lactate collected into the tissues, when there is reperfusion over there, it will lead to massive ischemia reperfusion syndrome, and it will lead to multiple organ failure. So patients with occult hypoperfusion, that is metabolic acidosis despite normal urine output. Patients with occult hypoperfusion, who are the patients with occult hypoperfusion? They are with metabolic acidosis despite normal urine output and cardiorespiratory vital signs. For more than 12 hours, they have a significantly higher mortality, infection rate, and incidence of multiple organ failure. What is decompensated shock? So decompensated shock is when the further loss of circulating volume overloads the, when there is no compensation available, there will be further loss of volume overloads the body's compensatory mechanism, and there is progressive renal, respiratory, and cardiovascular decompensation. In general, loss of around 15% of circulating blood volume is within normal compensatory mechanism. When blood pressure is usually well maintained and only falls after the 30 to 40% of circulating volume has been lost. So when there is loss of 30 to 40% of circulating volume, it automatically turns up into decompensated shock, mild shock. Initially there is tachycardia, tachypnea, and a mild reduction in the urine output initially. and the patient may exhibit mild anxiety. So these are the clinical features of shock, and this is compensated shock. In compensated shock, everything is normal except the pulse rate is mildly increased. Though there is lactic acidosis, but the other than the cool peripheries and tachycardia, there is no other sign of shock. This is an occult state. So compensated shock is actually having just a mild increase in pulse pressure and lactic acidosis. In mild decompensated shock, the lactic acidosis will increase, there will be a mild anxiety level, respiratory rate and tachycardia both will be there, tachypnea and tachycardia both will be there, blood pressure is still normal because it is within 15% of loss. So if blood pressure is normal, it means there is just 15% of loss or less than 15% of loss. So this comes under mild decompensated shock. When your blood pressure is still maintained, but tachycardia and tachypnea is there, conscious level, among the conscious level, there is just mild anxiety is there. So in moderate decompensated shock, the patient's blood pressure will start falling. So patient's blood pressure does not fall until and unless the loss is more than 15%. More than 15% in moderate decompensated shock, the blood pressure will start falling. When the blood pressure will start falling, the patient will start feeling drowsy. Tachy and tachycardia and tachypnea are still there, but urine output has also started falling. When blood pressure is falling, urine output is also started falling. Then there is severe decompensated shock. There is anuria, the labored breathing is there, patient is comatose, and there is severe hypotension. The severe decompensated shock, each and every parameter is almost hampered, and hampered very badly. So if you look into the mild shock, initially there is tachycardia, tachypnea, and a mild reduction in urine output. Initially, if they ask initially in the mild shock what happens, then there is, though in the chart it is showing the urine output is normal, initially there is mild reduction of urine output. So you have to remember this point also. And the patient may exhibit mild anxiety, but blood pressure is maintained. Although there is increase in pulse pressure, the peripheries are cool and sweaty with the prolonged capillary refill times. The peripheries are cool and sweaty with prolonged capillary refill time, except in septic distributive shock. When the peripheries are warm. Is an important MCQ here. Moderate shock. As shock progresses, renal compensatory mechanisms fail, renal perfusion falls, urine output dips below 0.5 ml per kg per hour, there is further tachy, and now the blood pressure starts to fall. And patient becomes drowsy and mildly confused. Then there is severe shock. In severe shock, there is profound tachy and hypotension. Urine output falls to zero. It is anuria, and patients are unconscious with labored respiration. Pitfalls. The characteristic cardiovascular response described are not seen in every patient. It is important to recognize the limitations of the clinical examination and to recognize the patient who are in shock despite the absence of classical signs. So what the points important about capillary refill? Now, most patients in hypovolemic shock will have cool, pale peripheries with prolonged capillary refill times. However, the actual capillary refill time varies so much in adults that is not a specific. So capillary refill time is not a specific marker whether a patient is shock or not. Patients with short capillary refill time may be in the early state of shock. In distributive shock, the peripheries will be warm. In distributive shock, the peripheries will be warm and there will be capillary refill will be brisk despite the profound shock. Even the profound shock, the capillary refill time will be brisk. Tachycardia. Tachycardia may not always accompany shock. Patients who are on beta blocker, very important, patients who are on beta blockers or who have implanted pacemakers are unable to mount a tachycardia. So a pulse rate of 80 in a fit young adult who normally has a pulse rate of 50 is very abnormal. But in some young patients with penetrating trauma, where there is hemorrhage but little tissue damage, there may be paradoxical bradycardia rather than tachycardia accompanying the shocked state. So the paradoxical bradycardia can be seen in penetrating trauma in some young patients. Blood pressure. It is important to recognize that hypotension is one of the last signs of shock. Children and fit young adults are able to maintain the blood pressure until the final stages of shock by dramatic increase in stroke volume and peripheral vasoconstriction. The patients can be in profound shock with a normal blood pressure also. Elderly patients who are normally hypertensive may present with the normal blood pressure. So elderly patient may have a normal blood pressure despite having hypovolemic or hypotensive relative to their usual blood pressure. Beta blockers or other medications may prevent a tachycardia response, but diagnosis of shock may be difficult unless one is alert to these pitfalls. Unresuscitable shock. Patients who are in profound shock for a prolonged period of time becomes unresuscitable. So cell death follows from cellular ischemia and the ability of the body to compensate is lost. There is myocardial depression and loss of responsiveness to fluid and ionotropic therapy. Peripherally, there is loss of the ability to maintain systemic vascular resistance. And further hypotension ensues. The peripheries no longer respond appropriately to vasopressor agents. Death is the inevitable result. Obviously, this stage of shock is a combined result of the severity of the insult and delayed, inadequate, inappropriate resuscitation in the earlier stages of shock. Conversely, when patients present in this late stage and have minimal response to maximal therapy, it is important that the futility of treatment is recognized and valuable resources are not wasted. Multiple organ failure. As techniques of resuscitation have improved, more and more patients are surviving the shock. Where intervention is timely and period of shock is limited, patients make a rapid, uncomplicated recovery. However, the result of prolonged systemic ischemia and reperfusion injury is yes. Prolonged systemic ischemia and pre-perfusion injuries, end organ damage and multiple organ failure. This is the end result. What is multiple organ failure? This question has appeared so many times in so many exams. It is even two or more failed organ systems. More than one, actually. So, any more than one organ failure is multiple organ failure. There is no specific treatment for multiple organ failure. No specific treatment available. Management is supporting the organ system with ventilation, cardiovascular support, and hemofiltration or dialysis until there is recovery of organ function. Multiple organ failures currently carries a mortality of 60% is the mortality in MODS. Thus, prevention is vital for early aggressive identification and reversal of shock. This has been a question in many exams. 60% is the mortality. So, effects of organ failure. In lung, it is acute respiratory distress syndrome. In kidneys, it is acute renal insufficiency. There is coagulability and cardiovascular failure. So, it's a simple thing. Resuscitation. Immediate resuscitation maneuvers for patients presenting in shock are to ensure a patient airway and adequate oxygenation and ventilation. Once airway and breathing are assessed and controlled, attention is directed to cardiovascular resuscitation. So, conduct of resuscitation. How will you do resuscitation? Resuscitation should not be delayed in order to definitely diagnose the source of the shock state. However, the timing and nature of resuscitation will depend on the type of shock, टाइमिंग एंड नेचर ऑफ रीसेसिटेशन विल डिपेंड ऑन द टाइप ऑफ शॉक एंड टाइमिंग एंड सीवियरिटी ऑफ द इंसल्ट. रैपिड क्लिनिकल एग्जामिनेशन विल प्रोवाइड एडिकेट क्लूज टू मेक एन अप्रोप्रिएट फर्स्ट डिटर्मिनेशन इवन इफ सोर्स ऑफ ब्लीडिंग और सेप्सिस इज नॉट इमीजिएटली आइडेंटिफाइबल. If there is initial doubt about the state of shock, of the cause of shock, it is safer to assume the case the cause is hypovolemic shock, that is the most common type of shock, and begin with fluid resuscitation. If you are not able to make out the cause of shock, the type of shock, you should thought it as hypovolemic shock and begin the fluid resuscitation as soon as possible, and there assess the response and then reassess the response. The patients who are actively bleeding, who are in major trauma, aortic aneurysmal rupture, GI hemorrhage, or it is counterproductive to initiate high volume therapy without controlling the site of hemorrhage. So first of all, you have to control the site of hemorrhage. This is most important. Even before the airway, you have to control the hemorrhage. It is CABC now. So increasing blood pressure merely increases bleeding from the site. If you will increase the blood pressure, it will again increase the bleeding from the site where the fluid therapy cools and patient and dilutes available the coagulation factor. So if it is still continuously bleeding, it will continuously bleeding if you increase the blood pressure by high volume fluid therapy, and your coagulation factor will be lost. Thus, operative hemorrhage control should not be delayed, and resuscitation should proceed in parallel. You should do control of hemorrhage and resuscitation in the parallel mechanism. Conversely, a patient with bowel obstruction and hypovolemic shock must be adequately resuscitated. So, if a patient presents to you with bowel obstruction and hypovolemic shock, bowel obstruction with hypovolemic shock, you should resuscitate the patient first before undergoing surgery. Otherwise, the additional surgery injury and hypovolemia induced during the procedure will exacerbate the inflammatory activation and increase the incidence and severity of end organ insult. In case of hemorrhage, you have to control the bleeding first, but in case of bowel obstruction and hypovolemic shock, you have to control the resuscitation first. You have to do the resuscitation first, fluid therapy. In all cases of shock, regardless of classification, hypovolemia and inadequate preload must be addressed before other therapy is instituted. Administration of inotropic or chronotropic agents to an empty heart will rapidly and permanently deplete the myocardium of oxygen stores. So you should not administer the inotropic or chronotropic agents without compensating the shock. They deplete the myocardium of oxygen stores and dramatically reduce the diastolic filling and therefore coronary perfusion. Patients will enter the unresuscitable state of shock as the myocardium becomes progressively more ischemic and unresponsive to resuscitative attempts. First line therapy therefore is IV access. This is the first line therapy and administration of IV fluids. Access should be through short wide bore catheters. Very important, it should be short wide bore catheters rather than long wide bore catheters. Short wide bore catheters. This question has been asked. This allows short wide bore catheters. They allow rapid infusion of fluids as necessary. Long narrow lines. The long narrow lines such as central venous catheters have too high a resistance to allow rapid infusion. So there is no added advantage of the long narrow lines like central venous catheters. So it is better to go for the short wide bore catheters and more appropriate for monitoring the fluid replace. They are appropriate for the monitoring of the fluid replacement therapy, but they are not very good at replacing the fluids. What other types of fluid should be used? There is continuing debate over which resuscitation fluid is best for the management of shock. That which resuscitation fluid is good? There is no ideal resuscitation fluid, and it is more important to understand how and when to administer it. In most studies of shock resuscitation, there is no overt difference in response or outcome between crystalloid solutions, normal saline or Hartmann solution or Ringer lactate or colloids. You should remember that there is no overt difference in response or outcomes between the crystalloids or colloids. Furthermore, there is less volume benefit to the administration of colloids. Volume benefit is definitely less when you are administering the colloids than had previously been thought, with only 1.3 times more crystalloids than colloid administration in blinded trials. On balance, there is little evidence to support the administration of colloids, so there is no much importance of administration of colloids. You better to go with crystalloids. Most importantly, the oxygen carrying capacity of crystalloids and colloids is zero. Most important point. If blood is being lost, the ideal replacement blood should be replaced with blood. Blood should be replaced with blood. And although the crystalloid therapy may be required while awaiting, until and unless the blood is available, you can move ahead with the crystalloid therapy. And when the blood arrives, you start infusing the blood and replace the blood with blood. So hypotonic solutions like dextrose, etc., the hypotonic solutions are poor volume expanders and should not be used in the treatment of shock. You should not use dextrose and all, which are the hypotonic solutions, in the treatment of shock unless the deficit is free water loss in diabetes insipidus and in cirrhosis when the patient is of sodium overload. So better to avoid the hypotonic solutions like dextrose and all, and if you are resuscitating a patient of shock until it is diabetes insipidus or cirrhosis. Dynamic fluid response. The shock status can be determined dynamically. So how will you determine dynamically the shock status? By the cardiovascular response to the rapid administration of a fluid bolus. In a total, 250 to 500 ml of fluid is rapidly given over 5 to 10 minutes, and the cardiovascular response in times of heart rate, BP and CVP are observed. Patient can be divided into responders and transient responders and non-responders. So who are responders? Responders who have an improvement in their cardiovascular status, that is sustained. There is sustained improvement in the cardiovascular status. These patients are not actively losing fluid but require filling to a normal volume status. They are not actively losing fluids. Who are transient responders? Transient responders, they have an improvement, but this then reverts to the previous state over the next 10 to 20 minutes. They are not sustaining the improvement. These patients have moderate ongoing because they have ongoing fluid losses, either overt hemorrhage or further fluid shift reducing the intravascular volume. Then there are non-responders. They are severe volume depleted and are likely to be a major ongoing loss of intravascular. If there is major and ongoing loss of intravascular volume, they will be non-responders until unless you control the hemorrhage. Vascular and inotropic support. Vasopressor and inotropic support. What is the role? Vasopressor or inotropic therapy is not indicated as first line. This is not indicated as first line therapy in hypovolemia. As discussed above, administration of these agents in the absence of adequate preload rapidly leads to decreased coronary perfusion. If you will give vasopressor or inotropic support, it will further decrease the coronary perfusion and depletion of the myocardial oxygen reserves. Vasopressor agents like phenylephrine, noradrenaline, they are indicated in distributive shock. Very important. Usually vasopressor agent and inotropic support is not to be given in hypovolemic shock, but yes, they should be given in distributive shock status like sepsis or neurogenic shock when there is peripheral vasodilatation and there is low systemic vascular resistance because vascular tone is not there, because sympathetic tone is not there, leading to the hypotension despite a high cardiac output. Though there is high cardiac output, there is no point giving more and more fluid because there is peripheral vasodilatation. So better to give your vasopressor agents. When the vasodilatation is resistant to the catecholamines, for example, absolute or relative steroid deficiency, vasopressin may be used as an alternative. So when will you use vasopressins? You will also use vasopressins when there is resistant vasodilatation, resistant to catecholamines. In cardiogenic shock or where myocardial depression has complicated a shock state, like in severe septic shock with low cardiac output, if there is severe septic shock along with the low cardiac output, it will lead to myocardial depression, and the treatment here will be inotropic therapy. In cardiogenic shock or where myocardial depression has complicated a shock state, that is severe septic shock with low cardiac output, आइनोट्रोपिक थेरेपी में भी रिक्वायर्ड टू इंक्रीज द कार्डिक आउटपुट एंड देयर फॉर ऑक्सीजन डिलीवरी. वट इज द आइनोडाइलेटर ऑफ चॉइस? आइनोडाइलेटर ऑफ चॉइस इज डॉब्यूटामीन. मॉनिटरिंग, द मिनिमम स्टैंडर्ड ऑफ मॉनिटरिंग ऑफ द पेशेंट टू शॉक इज कंटिन्यूस हार्ट रेट. दिस इज द मिनिमम यू शुड मॉनिटर वट हार्ट रेट एंड ऑक्सीजन सेचुरेशन मॉनिटरिंग. नॉट रिक्वायर्ड the what is not required in the monitoring, minimum monitoring ECG is required, pulse ox is required, BP and urine output is required. This is the minimum requirement, and among that also the oxygen saturation and heart rate are the utmost requirement, along with the frequent non-invasive BP monitoring and early urine output measurements. Heart rate, oxygen saturation, ब्लड प्रेशर एंड यूरिन आउटपुट. मोस्ट पेशेंट्स विल नीड मोर एग्रेसिव इन्वेजिव मॉनिटरिंग इंक्लूडिंग द सेंट्रल वीनस प्रेशर. मोस्ट पेशेंट विल ऑल्सो नीड द सेंट्रल वीनस प्रेशर एंड इन्वेजिव बीपी मॉनिटरिंग ऑल्सो. दीज आर द एडिशनल मोडेलिटीज, सीवीपी, इन्वेजिव ब्लड प्रेशर, कार्डिक आउटपुट एंड बेस डेफिसिट. बट मिनिमम दिस इज रिक्वायर्ड, द ईसीजी, द पल्स ऑक्स, the blood pressure, the urine output. Cardiovascular. Cardiovascular monitoring at minimum should include the ECG, the oxygen saturation, and the pulse waveform and non-invasive blood pressure. This is the minimum cardiovascular cardiovascular monitoring. Patients whose state of shock is not rapidly corrected with a small amount of fluid should have central venous pressure. Patients whose state of shock is not rapidly corrected with a small amount of fluid, they should have central venous pressure monitoring and continuous blood pressure monitoring through an arterial line. Central venous pressure. There is no normal central venous pressure for a shocked patient, and reliance cannot be placed on an individual pressure measurement to assess the volume status. Some patient may require a CVP of 5 and some may require CVP of 15 or higher. Further, the ventricular compliance can change from minute to minute in the shocked state, and CVP is a poor reflection. So CVP is a poor reflection of end diastolic volume. CVP measurement should be assessed dynamically as response to a fluid change. You should check CVP response by giving 250 to 500 ml of fluid bolus over 5 to 10 minutes. A normal CVP response is a rise in 2 to 5 cm of water. This is a normal response, which gradually drifts back to original lower level over 10 to 20 minutes in partial responders, it will go back. Patients with no change in the CVP are empty and require further fluid resuscitation. So patients who are not responding to CVP are actually empty and require further fluid resuscitation. And patients with a large sustained rise in CVP, have high preload and an element of cardiac insufficiency or volume overload. If there is a large and sustained rise in CVP, the patient should be thought of cardiac insufficiency or volume overload. Cardiac output. The cardiac output monitoring allows assessment of not only the cardiac output but also the systemic vascular resistance. And depending on the techniques used, end diastolic volume and the preload and the blood volume. Use of invasive cardiac monitoring with pulmonary artery catheter is becoming less frequent, and new invasive monitoring techniques such as Doppler and Doppler ultrasound, pulse waveform analysis and indicator dilution methods provide similar information. Measurements of cardiac output, systemic vascular resistance and preload can help distinguish the types of shock present, like hypovolemia, distributive cardiogenic, any type of shock. Measurements of cardiac output, systemic vascular resistance and preload. So the information provided guides the fluid and vasopressor therapy by providing real-time monitoring of the cardiovascular response. Measurement of cardiac output is desired in patients who do not respond or expected to first-line therapy. Measurement of cardiac output is desirable in patients who are not responding to the first-line therapy or who have an evidence of cardiogenic shock or myocardial dysfunction. Early consideration should be given to institutional cardiac output monitoring for patients who require vasopressor or inotropic support. Who are at vasopressor and inotropic support, these patients should require the institutional cardiac monitoring. Systemic and organ perfusion. Ultimately, the goal of treatment is to restore the cellular and organ perfusion. Ideally, monitoring of organ perfusion should guide the management of shock. The best measure of organ perfusion, and this is very, very, very important, 100 times asked question. The best measure of organ perfusion and best monitor of adequacy of shock, both the organ perfusion and best management of adequacy of shock therapy, remains the urine output. However, this is an hourly measure and does not give a minute-to-minute volume. It does not give you minute-to-minute view. This level of consciousness is an important marker of cerebral perfusion. The level of consciousness, how will you manage the cerebral perfusion? The level of consciousness. But brain perfusion is maintained until the very late state of shock and hence is a poor marker of adequacy of resuscitation. Currently, they are saying that level of consciousness is not a good marker. Currently, the only clinical indicator of perfusion of the GI tract and muscular beds are the global measurement of lactic acid. The only clinical indicator of perfusion of the GIT and muscular beds are the lactic acid measurement, the lactates and base deficit, and also the mixed venous oxygen saturation. This is a very, very important table here. Systemic perfusion is clinically, it is not being judged. Investigations for systemic perfusion are base deficit, lactate levels, and MVO2. For organ perfusion of muscle, near infrared spectroscopy and tissue oxygen electrodes. For gut, it is sublingual capnometry, gut mucosal pH and laser Doppler flowmetry. For kidney, the urine output is the best clinical indicator, but tissue oxygen electrode is for brain, and also the near infrared spectroscopy. What is important here is the sublingual capnometry. Sublingual capnometry is used in gut. For muscle, you know that it is near infrared spectroscopy, but for gut, it is sublingual capnometry, gut mucosal pH, and laser Doppler flowmetry. Lactic acid is generated by cells undergoing anaerobic respiration. The degree of lactic acidosis as measured by serum lactate levels and the base deficit is sensitive for both diagnosis of shock and monitoring the response of therapy. Patients with a base deficit of 6 millimole per liter, they have a much higher morbidity. Very important. Patients with a base deficit of 6 millimole per liter, they have a much higher morbidity and mortality than those with no metabolic acidosis. Furthermore, the length of time in shock with an increased base deficit is also important. Even if all other vital signs have returned to the normal. We will see endpoint of resuscitation. These parameters are measured from arterial ABG analysis, the lactate levels, the base deficit. We can monitor these response from the ABG analysis, and therefore the frequency of measurements is limited, and they do not provide minute-to-minute data on systemic perfusion. Definitely, they do not provide. Nevertheless, the base deficit or lactate should be measured routinely until they have returned to normal levels. MVO2, the percentage saturation of oxygen returning to the heart from the body. What is MVO2? This is the oxygen saturation returning to the heart of the fired from the body. This is a measure of oxygen delivery and extraction by the tissues. Accurate measurement is via analysis of blood drawn from a large. How will you detect the MVO2? It will be via the analysis of blood drawn from a large central line placed in the right atrium. You have to place a central line in the right atrium, and then only you can analyze the MVO2. Estimations can be made from blood drawn from lines in the SVC also. You can estimate from lines in the SVC, but a correct measurement is when you put the lines in the atrium, right atrium. बट दीज वैल्यूज विल बी स्लाइटली हायर देन दोज ऑफ द एम वी ओ टू. दी हाँ, द सुपीरियर वीना केवल वैल्यूज विल बी स्लाइटली हायर एज देर इज रिलेटिवली मोर ऑक्सीजन एक्सट्रैक्शन फ्रॉम द लोअर हाफ ऑफ द बॉडी. यस. नॉर्मल, वट इज नॉर्मल, वट इज नॉर्मल, वट इज नॉर्मल मिक्सड वीनस ऑक्सीजन सेचुरेशन 50 to 70%. 50 to 70%. एंड लेवल्स बिलो 50% दे इंडिकेट इन एडिकेट ऑक्सीजन डिलीवरी. द लेवल्स बिलो 50% इंडिकेट इन एडिकेट ऑक्सीजन डिलीवरी एंड इंक्रीज ऑक्सीजन एक्सट्रैक्शन. दिस इज कंसिस्टेंट विद हाइपोवोलीमिक शॉक और कार्डियोजेनिक शॉक. वैन टिश्यूज आर एक्सट्रैक्टिंग मोर एंड मोर ऑक्सीजन द लेवल्स विल फॉल बिलो 50% नॉर्मल विच इज 50 to 70%. हाई, वैन विल इट बी हाई मिक्स वीनस ऑक्सीजन सेचुरेशन? इट विल बी सीन इन सेप्सिस एंड इन अदर फॉर्म्स ऑफ डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव शॉक. वी सॉ दैट इन सेप्सिस एंड इन अदर फॉर्म्स ऑफ डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव शॉक द टिश्यूज आर नॉट एबल टू यूटिलाइज द ऑक्सीजन. सो इन सेप्सिस देर इज डिसऑर्डर्ड यूटिलाइजेशन ऑफ ऑक्सीजन एट द थैलर लेवल एंड ए वी शंटिंग ऑफ द ब्लड एट द माइक्रोवास्कुलर. देर इज ऑल्सो ए वी शंटिंग ऑफ द blood at the microvascular level. Therefore, less oxygen is present in the to the cells and those cells are not able to utilize oxygen very much. Thus, venous blood has a higher oxygen concentration than normal. Patients who are septic should therefore have mixed venous oxygen saturation above 70%. In septic patient, the MbO2 should be above 70%. Below this level, they are not only in septic shock but also in hypovolemic or ha. If the patients are associated along with septic and hypovolemic shock both, it can be below 50%. Therefore, the mixed venous oxygen saturation level is in the normal range if it is low for septic. Yes, although the SpO2 level is in normal range, it is low for septic state and inadequate oxygen is being supplied to the cells that cannot utilize. This must be corrected rapidly. Hypovolemia should be corrected with fluid therapy and low cardiac output should be with due to myocardial depression or failure should be treated with inotropes. You should give both fluid therapy and inotropes to achieve MVO2 more than 70%. New methods for monitoring regional tissue perfusion and oxygenation are becoming available and the most promising which are muscle tissue oxygen probes. These are the new methods. What are new methods? Then muscle tissue oxygen probes, near infrared spectroscopy and sublingual. We saw that near infrared spectroscopy, the sublingual capnometry is for gut perfusion. While these techniques provide information regarding perfusion of specific tissue beds, it is yet unclear whether there are significant advantages over existing measurements of global perfusion. The endpoints of resuscitation. It is much easier to know when to start resuscitation than when to stop. Traditionally, patients have been resuscitated until they have a normal pulse, blood pressure, and urine output. However, these parameters are monitoring organ systems whose blood flow is preserved until the late stages of shock. So, a patient therefore may be resuscitated to restore the central perfusion to the brain, lungs, and kidney, and yet continue to underperfuse the gut and muscle beds. Thus, the activation of inflammation and coagulation may be ongoing and lead to reperfusion injury when these organs are finally perfused and ultimately multi-organ failure. This state of normal vital signs and continued underperfusion is termed as occult hyperperfusion. With current monitoring and occult hyperperfusion is happening in actually gut and muscle beds. So, with current monitoring techniques, it is manifested only by a persistent lactic acidosis. Under current mechanisms, monitoring techniques, it is manifested only by a persistent lactic acidosis and low mixed venous oxygen saturation. So the time spent by patients in this hypoperfused states had a dramatic effect on outcome. Patients with occult hyperperfusion were more than 12 hours. Patient with occult hypoperfusion for more than 12 hours have 2 to 3 times the mortality of patients with a limited duration of shock. Resuscitation algorithms are accurate at correcting the blood perfusion and endpoints. What are the global perfusion endpoints? Very important question. It is the base deficit, the lactate, MVO2, SpO2, the mixed venous oxygen saturation, rather than the traditional endpoints, have been shown to improve mortality and morbidity in high-risk patients. However, it is clear that despite aggressive regimes, some patients cannot be resuscitated to normal parameters within 12 hours by fluid resuscitation alone. More research underway. Hemorrhage. Hemorrhage must be recognized and managed aggressively to reduce the severity and duration of shock and avoid the death and multi-organ failure. Hemorrhage is treated by arresting the bleeding, not by the fluid resuscitation. It should be treated by arresting the bleeding. Although necessary are supportive measures to maintain organ perfusion, attempting to resuscitate the patients who have ongoing hemorrhage will lead to physiological exhaustion. That is, this is physiological exhaustion. Coagulopathy, acidosis, and hypothermia, also known as the triangle of death. Pathophysiology. Hemorrhage leads to a state of hypovolemic shock. The combination of tissue trauma and hypovolemic shock leads to the development of an endogenous coagulopathy, also known as the acute traumatic coagulopathy. Up to 25% of trauma patients, they develop ATC within minutes of injury, and it is associated with a four-fold increase in the mortality. It is likely that ATC, the acute traumatic coagulopathy, exists whenever there is combination of shock and tissue trauma. So, whenever there will be a shock and tissue trauma, the acute traumatic coagulopathy will be there. ATC is a component of trauma-induced coagulopathy, which is ultimately multifactorial. Ongoing bleeding with fluid and RBC resuscitation leads to dilation of the coagulation factor, which worsens the coagulopathy. In addition, the acidosis induced by the hypoperfused state leads to decreased function of the coagulation proteases, resulting in coagulopathy and further hemorrhage. The reduced tissue perfusion includes reduced tissue supply to muscle beds. Underperfused muscle is unable to generate heat and hypothermia ensues. Coagulation functions poorly at the low temperature and there is further hemorrhage, further hypoperfusion and worsening acidosis and hypothermia. These three factors result in downward spiral leading to the physiological exhaustion and death. Medical therapy has a tendency to worsen this effect. Intravenous blood and fluids are cold and exacerbate the hypothermia. Obviously, they will exacerbate. So, further heat is lost by opening the body cavities also. During the surgery, usually leads to further bleeding and many crystalloid fluids are themselves acidic. Like normal saline has a pH of 6.7. This question has been asked multiple times previously. What is the pH of normal saline? So, normal saline has a pH of 6.7. Every effort must therefore be made to rapidly identify and stop the hemorrhage and to avoid or limit the physiological exhaustion from coagulopathy, acidosis and hypothermia. This is the trauma-induced coagulopathy. When there is trauma, it will lead to acute traumatic coagulopathy because of fibrinolysis and inflammation going on. The shock will lead to hypothermia and acidemia, and there will be hemorrhage, all leading to trauma-induced coagulopathy. Definition. Revealed and concealed hemorrhages. What is revealed? Hemorrhage may be revealed or concealed. Revealed hemorrhage is obvious external hemorrhage, such an exsanguination from an open arterial wound or from massive hemostomiasis from a duodenal ulcer. Even massive hematemesis from a duodenal ulcer is a revealed bleeding. Concealed hemorrhage is contained within the body cavity and must be suspected, actively investigated and controlled. In trauma, hemorrhage may be concealed within the chest, abdomen, pelvis, retroperitoneum or in limbs with contained vascular injury or associated with long bone fractures. Examples of non-traumatic concealed hemorrhage include occult gastrointestinal bleed or ruptured aortic aneurysm. Primary, reactionary and secondary hemorrhage. What is primary hemorrhage? It is occurring immediately due to an injury. What is reactionary hemorrhage? Reactionary hemorrhage is within 24 hours. And reactionary hemorrhage is also delayed hemorrhage. And is usually due to the... Why it happens? Why there is reactionary hemorrhage? It's a very important question. Because the dislodgement of a clot by resuscitation, normalization of blood pressure and vasodilatation. Reactionary hemorrhage may also be due to technical failure such as slippage of ligature. Secondary hemorrhage is actually due to sloughing of the wall of vessel. Infection is causing secondary hemorrhage. Primary hemorrhage is due to
Why? Because it is due to surgery. Reactionary hemorrhage is due to because of dislodgement of clot, normalization of blood pressure and vasodilatation. While the secondary hemorrhage, it is due to infection, due to sloughing of the wall of a vessel. It usually occurs 7 to 14 days after injury and is precipitated. 7 to 14 days after injury is secondary hemorrhage and is precipitated by factors such as infection, pressure necrosis, such as the drain. If drain is causing the pressure necrosis and eventually bleeding, it is actually secondary hemorrhage happening 7 to 14 days after the surgery. On malignancy also. So surgery and non-surgical hemorrhages. Surgical hemorrhages is due to the direct injury and amenable to surgical control. Non-surgical hemorrhages in the general ooze from all the raw surfaces due to coagulopathy and cannot be stopped. It cannot be stopped by surgical means except the pecking. Treatment requires correction of the coagulation abnormalities. Now the degree and classification. The adult human has approximately 5 liter 70 ml per kg in children and adults and 80 ml per kg in neonates. Estimation of amount of blood that has been lost is difficult, inaccurate and usually underestimating the actual value. External hemorrhage is obvious. It may be difficult to estimate the actual volume lost. In the operating room, blood collection in suction apparatus can be measured and swab soaked in blood weighted. It can be weighted. So hemoglobin level is a very poor indicator of degree of hemorrhage because it represents a concentration and is not the actual amount. In the early stages of rapid hemorrhage, the hemoglobin concentration is unchanged early phases as whole blood is lost. Later, as the fluid shifts from the intracellular and interstitial spaces, now the hemoglobin will decrease and also the hematocrit. The amount of hemorrhage can be classified into class 1 to 4 based on the estimated blood loss required to produce certain physiological compensatory changes. What are those 1 to 4? These are the 4 classes. Within less than 15 years, the class 1. 15 to 30 years, 30%, class 2. 30 to 40%, class 3. And more than 40% blood volume loss is class 4. Although the conceptually useful, there is variation across ages. The young compensate well and old very poor. Variation among individuals like athletes versus the obese and variation due to confounding factors, concomitant medication and pain. Treatment should therefore be based upon the degree of hypovolemic shock according to the vital signs, preload assessment. Yes, it should be based upon the degree of hypovolemic shock according to vital signs, preload assessment, base deficit, and most important, what is the most important thing, is dynamic response to fluid therapy. Patients who are non-responders or transient responder are still bleeding and must have site of hemorrhage identified and controlled. Management. Identify the hemorrhage. External hemorrhage may be obvious, but the diagnosis of concealed hemorrhage may be more difficult. Any shock should be assumed to be a hypovolemic until proven otherwise. We have read that. Immediate resuscitative measures. Direct pressure should be placed over the site of external hemorrhage. Airway and breathing should be assessed and controlled. Large bore IV cannula. Short large bore IV cannula. Short wide bore IV cannula. They should be instituted and blood drawn for the cross-matching. Cross-matching should be done. The emergency blood should be requested if the degree of shock and ongoing hemorrhage warrants this. Identify the site of hemorrhage. Once hemorrhage has been considered, the site of hemorrhage must be rapidly identified. Note, this is to identify the exact location definitely, but rather to define the next step in hemorrhage control for the operation, angioembolization and endoscopic control. Clues may be in the history or examination. For shocked trauma patients, the external signs of injury may suggest internal hemorrhage, but hemorrhage may be in the body cavity. It should be excluded with rapid investigations. Investigations for blood loss must be appropriate to the patient's physiological condition. Rapid bedside tests are more appropriate for profound shock and exsanguinate hemorrhages than investigation of CT. The investigation is fast. Patients who are not actively bleeding can have a much methodical, definitive workup. Hemorrhage control. The bleeding shocked patient, they must be moved rapidly to a place of hemorrhage control. This will this is usually be in the operating room and maybe the angiography or endoscopic suite. These patients require surgical and anesthetic support, and full monitoring and equipment must be available. Hemorrhage control must be achieved rapidly to prevent the patient entering the triad of coagulopathy. What is the triad of coagulopathy? Acidosis and hypothermia is known as death, triad of death, triangle of death. There should be no unnecessary investigation or procedure. Acidosis, coagulopathy, and hypothermia. There should be no unnecessary investigation or procedure prior to hemorrhage control to minimize the duration of severity of shock. This includes the prolonged attempts to volume resuscitation the patient prior to surgery, which will result in further hypothermia and clotting factor dilution until the bleeding is stopped. Attention should be paid to correction of coagulopathy with blood component therapy to aid the surgical hemorrhagic control. Surgical intervention may need to be limited to the minimum necessary to stop bleeding and control sepsis. This should be surgical intervention. It should be limited to the minimum necessary to stop bleeding and control sepsis. More definite repairs should be delayed. This is known as damage control surgery. The patient is hemodynamically stable until the patient is hemodynamically stable and physiologically capable of sustaining the pressure. The procedure. The concept of tailoring the operation to match the patient physiology and staged procedure to prevent physiological exhaustion is known as damage control surgery, which is a term borrowed from the military, which ensures continued functioning of a damaged ship above conducting complete repairs, which would prevent rapid return to battle. Once hemorrhage is controlled, Once hemorrhage is controlled, patient should be aggressively resuscitated, warmed, and coagulopathy is corrected. What you have to do once hemorrhage is controlled? Aggressively resuscitate, warmed, and coagulopathy is corrected. All three the triangle of death. Attention should be paid to fluid responsiveness and the endpoints of resuscitation to ensure the patients are fully resuscitated and to reduce the incidence and severity of organ failure. So damage control surgery includes the hemorrhage control, sepsis control, protection from the further injury, nothing else. Damage control, resuscitation. Damage control, resuscitation, these concepts have been combined into a new paradigm for the management of trauma patient with active hemorrhage called damage control resuscitation. The four central strategies for DCR, first is anticipate and treat the acute traumatic coagulopathy. Anticipate and treat acute traumatic coagulopathy, permissive hypotension until the hemorrhage control. Limit crystalloid and colloid infusions to avoid the dilutional coagulopathy. Damage control surgery to control the hemorrhage and preserve physiology. First, you have to anticipate. Second, you have to permit the hypotension. Third, you have to limit the crystalloids. Then you have to control. Anticipate, permit, limit, control. Anticipate, permit, limit, control. Anticipate the coagulopathy. Permit the hypotension. Limit the infusion. Control the damage. Transfusion. The transfusion of blood and blood products has become commonplace since the first successful transfusion done in 1818. Although the incidence of severe transfusion reactions and infection is now very low, in recent years it has become apparent that there is an immunological price to be paid from the transfusion of heterologous blood, leading to increased morbidity and decreased survival in certain population groups, which is trauma and malignancy. Suppliers are also limited, and therefore the use of blood and blood products must always be judicious and justified for clinical use. The Landsteiner discovered the ABO system in 1901. 1818, first successful documented blood transfusion in a woman suffering from PPH was done. Husband gave the blood. 1924, the first non-direct transfusion was done. Rhesus system was identified in 39. Blood and blood products. Blood is collected from donors who have been previously screened before donating to exclude any donor whose blood may have the potential to harm the patient or to prevent possible harm that donating a unit of blood may have an on the donor. In the UK, up to 450 ml is drawn, a maximum of 3 times each year. Each unit is tested for evidence of B, C, hepatitis, HIV and syphilis. Donation are leukodepleted against the variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. So leukodepleted blood can prevent from CZ, Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. This may also reduce the immunogenicity of the transfusion. The ABO and rhesus D blood groups are determined, as well as the presence of irregular RBC antibodies. The blood is then processed into subcomponents. Whole blood is now rarely available in civilian practice because it has been seen as an inefficient use of a limited resources. However, whole blood transfusion has significant advantage over packed RBC, as it is coagulation factor rich and fresh, more metabolically active than a stored blood. Packed RBC are spun down and concentrated packs of RBCs. Each unit is approximately 330 ml and has a hematocrit of 50-70%. Packed cells are stored in SAG-M solution, that is saline adenine glucose mannitol solution, to increase the shelf life to 5 weeks. Packed RBC has a shelf life of 5 weeks when you are using SAG-M solution at 2-6 degree centigrade storage. Older storage regime, including storage in CPD, which was the older uses was of CPD, which was citrate phosphate dextrose solution shelf with a shelf life of 2-3 weeks. Now we have improved our shelf life also, and the shelf life only. So fresh frozen plasma rich in coagulation factors and removed from fresh blood and stored at -40 to -50. The packed RBC was stored at 2-6 degree. Fresh frozen plasma has been stored at -40 to -50. But it has a 2-year of shelf life. It is the first line therapy in the treatment of coagulopathic hemorrhage, management of coagulopathy. Rhesus D positive fresh frozen plasma may be given to rhesus negative. So rhesus group doesn't matter when you are using fresh frozen plasma. All points are very important. Each and every point has been asked in the exam. Cryoprecipitate is a supernatant precipitate of fresh frozen plasma, and it is rich in factor 8 and fibrinogen. It is stored in -30 degree centigrade with a 2-year of shelf life. When it should be used in low fibrinogen states or factor 8 deficiency. Platelets. Platelets are supplied as a pooled platelet concentrate containing about 250 multiplied by 10⁻⁹ per liter. 250 multiplied by 10⁻⁹ per liter. And platelets are stored on a special aggregate agitator at 20-40 degree and have a shelf life of only 5 days. This is important. Platelet transfusion are given to patients with thrombocytopenia or with platelet dysfunction who are bleeding or undergoing surgery. Patients are increasingly presenting on antiplatelet therapy, such as we know that antiplatelet therapies, when used, aspirin therapy rarely poses a problem, but control of hemorrhage on a more potent platelet antibeater can be extremely difficult. Patients on clopidogrel who are actively bleeding and undergoing major surgery may require almost continuous infusion of platelets during the course of procedure. Arginine vasopressin and its analogs, the DDAVP, has also been used in the patient group, although with limited success. So you can use DDAVP, arginine vasopressin therapy, to the patients with clopidogrel use. Prothrombin complex concentrates, highly purified concentrates prepared from pooled plasma. They contain 2, 9, 10, 12. It may be included or produced separately. It is indicated for the emergency reversal. Only important question. Which component is used for emergency reversal of anticoagulant or warfarin therapy in uncontrolled hemorrhage? Answer is prothrombin complex concentrates, autologous blood. Autologous blood, it is possible for patients undergoing elective surgery to donate their own blood up to 3 weeks from surgery. You have to donate your own blood 3 weeks before surgery, 3 weeks or before surgery to use it as autologous. Similarly, during surgery, blood can be collected in a cell sieve which washes and collects the red bloods which can be returned to the patient. Indication of blood transfusion. Indication: blood transfusion should be avoided if possible, and many previous uses of blood and blood products are now no longer considered appropriate. The indications: acute blood loss to replace circulating volume and maintain the oxygen delivery, perioperative anemia, symptomatic chronic anemia. What is transfusion trigger? Previously, patients were transfused to achieve a hemoglobin of more than 10. This has now been shown not only to be unnecessary but also to be associated with increased morbidity. A hemoglobin level 6 is acceptable in patients who are not actively bleeding, not about to undergo surgery, and are not symptomatic. Very important. You can manage even blood group 6 or blood level 6 who is not bleeding or who is not undergoing surgery and who is not symptomatic. There is some controversy about the optimal hemoglobin level in some patient groups, such as those with the cardiovascular disease, sepsis and traumatic brain injury. Although the conceptually a higher hemoglobin level improves oxygen delivery, there is a little clinical evidence at this stage to support the higher levels in these groups. So when will you donate the blood? When will you transfuse the blood? Less than 6 you have to transfuse without any other thought. More than 8, no indication. 6 to 8 if transfusion is unlikely to benefit in the absence of bleeding or impending surgery. Blood groups and cross matching. Blood groups are ABO and RH groups. These proteins are strongly antigenic and are associated with naturally occurring antibodies in the serum. These systems consist of three allelic groups, the A, B and O, which controls the synthesis of enzymes that add carbohydrate residues to cell surface glycoproteins. A and B genes add specific residues, while the O gene is an amorph and does not transform the glycoprotein. The system allows for 6 possible genotypes, although there are only 4 phenotypes. 6 possible genotypes, but only 4 phenotypes. Naturally occurring antibodies are found in the serum of those lacking the antigen. Antibodies in the serum, those lacking the antigens. So, if you look at the ABO blood group, O is lacking all the antigens, but both the antibodies are present. It is most common. O is most common blood group. AB, which is lacking any antibody but presented with all the antigens, is minimum. Rhesus system. Rhesus antigen is strongly antigenic and is present in approximately 85% of the population. Antibodies to the D antigen are not naturally present in the serum of the remaining 15%, but their formation may be stimulated by the product, the transfusion of Rh positive red cells, or acquired during delivery of Rh positive baby. Acquired antibodies are capable during pregnancy of crossing the placenta, and if present, Rh negative mother may cause severe hemolytic anemia and even death, that is Hydrops fetalis, in an Rh positive fetus. If mother is Rh negative and fetus is Rh positive, it may cause Hydrops fetalis. The other minor blood group antigens may be associated with naturally occurring antibodies or may be stimulate the formation of antibodies on relatively rare occasions. Transfusion reactions. If antibodies present in the recipient serum are incompatible with the donor cells, or transfusion reactions will result. This usually takes the form of an acute hemolytic. Usually it is acute hemolytic reaction. Severe immune related transfusion reaction due to ABO incompatibility result in potentially fatal complement mediated. The severe reactions will cause complement mediated intravascular hemolysis and multi-organ failure. Transfusion reactions from other antigen system are usually milder. Febrile transfusion reactions are non-hemolytic and are usually caused by graft versus host response from leukocytes. Leukocytes are actually causing the febrile transfusion reactions. They are non-hemolytic. Leukocytes are causing the febrile transfusion reactions and are usually non-hemolytic. Such reactions are associated with fever chills and rigor. The blood transfusion should be stopped immediately. This form of transfusion is with leukodepleted blood. This form of transfusion is rare and with leukodepleted blood. Cross matching. To prevent transfusion, you do cross matching. So all transfusions are preceded by ABO and RH type. The recipient serum, recipient ka serum with the donor cells to confirm donor blood cells and recipient serum is used. Very important question to test the rhesus and any other antigen antibody reaction. The full cross matching will take around 45 minutes. In most of the laboratories, in most urgent situation, the type specific blood is provided, which is only ABO-RH matched and can be issued within 10 to 15 minutes, where blood must be given emergency. Group O is universal donor. Iska blood used karo. Blood is given O negative to females and O positive to males. This is also very important. Very, very important paragraph, guys. That for O negative should be given O negative to females and O positive to males. So when transfusion blood transfusion is prescribed and blood is administered, it is essential that the correct patient receives the correct transfusion. Two personnel should check the patient's details against the prescription and the label of the donor blood. In addition, the donor blood serial number should also be checked against the issue slip. Provided these principles are strictly adhered to, the number of severe and fatal ABO compatibilities, complication of blood transfusion, complication from a single transfusion, complication from massive transfusion. Complication from single transfusion lead to incompatibility, hemolytic transfusion reaction, febrile transfusion reaction due to leukocyte, allergic reactions, infections of HIV, malaria, hepatitis or anything, air embolism, thrombophlebitis, transfusion related acute lung injury is usually due to AFFP. Then coagulopathy, the massive transfusion complications are coagulopathy, hypocalcemia, hyperkalemia, hypokalemia and hypothermia. Potassium can be low or high, but calcium will always be low. Temperature obviously goes low and coagulopathy will be there. In addition, patient who receive the repeated transfusion over long periods of time, like patients with thalassemia, they may develop iron overload. Each transfused unit of RBC contains 250 mg of elemental iron. Management of coagulopathy. Only thing important that it should be given the RBC, packed cells, FFP and platelets. They should be given in the ratio of 1:1:1. Nowadays, they are using the blood substitutes. They are an attractive alternative to the donation checking and all can be bypassed. There are several oxygen carrying blood substitutes under investigation in experimental animals. Blood substitutes are either biomimetic or abiotic. The biomimetic substitutes mimic the standard oxygen carrying capacity of the blood and are hemoglobin based. Abiotic ones are synthetic oxygen carriers and currently primarily perfluorocarbon based. So a question if asked can be, what is the new blood substitutes being under testing? These are perfluorocarbon based. So hemoglobin is seen as the obvious candidate for developing an effective blood substitute. Various engineered molecules are under clinical trials and are based on human bovine or recombinant technologies. Second generation perfluorocarbon emulsions are also showing potential in the clinical trials. Thank you.